At ease and be seated.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the War Room. Today you're going to receive a briefing from General Patton. You're getting the same briefing that the General gets. The G1 will be starting, the G2, I'm the G3. I'm in charge of the War Room and basic operations for 3rd Army. The General tells me what he wants, and I make sure it happens. Okay, no ifs, ands, or buts, because you know how the General can be. All right, as soon as we're done in here, you'll have plenty of opportunities to ask the General all kind of questions. You can probably get a picture with him, whatever it is you would like. If you're a veteran, especially get your picture with him. All right, we have a tent just out back that has the first sergeant set up in it and a little bit of a display in there. If you would like to walk through that, the first sergeant will be in there and he'll be able to answer any questions that you may have. All right, we're going to start with the briefing by the G1, Lieutenant Junjun.
General, good morning, as it will. I will be giving you the briefing for G1. In the 20th Corps, we had to strengthen the regiment combat team with the task and tank destroyer units. Due to counterattack on the 5th ID, 150 were killed and 200 were wounded. We are not getting replacements as needed, and we are talking to the 12th Army Group to solve that. Supplies for the Graves registration are critical. We are meeting but unavailable to get 2,000 mattress covers and 3,000 personal effects bags. It is necessary to send trucks 300 miles to Normandy beachheads to obtain these items, as well as rations and ammunition. Good news, General, though, is TAC Air just delivered 12,000 gallons of gasoline. That'll last us about 2 days. 100,000 pounds of green coffee were received and are being roasted by bakeries immediately. And sir, that concludes my presentation. Do you have any questions?
I want you to get General Gay on the phone to General Lee in Supply in Paris.
Okay.
You tell him that Patton will be calling on him to find out why the hell we don't have what we need for grave registration.
Yes, sir.
That's your number one priority. I am not going to let them soldiers lie around and be treated like all the rest of the soldiers that have fought on this continent. We have the finest men around. You get that taken care of first. If you have trouble with graves, you get the Germans to dig the damn graves, and you get it done. I don't want any of our men to walk around and see any of our graves. They can see the German graves.
Yes, sir.
All right.
G2, Captain Rowden. Lieutenant Hart.
Good morning, sir. This is our situation currently with the military intelligence. We have currently troops north of the line of over here by Metz in the Maginot Line. We were hit pretty hard just the other day with the 3rd Division. I believe it was from the 462nd Division, Germans. They hit our fellows pretty hard. Our men are without proper maps. They all have Michelin road maps, of all things, sir. And they have no idea of the fortifications of the Maginot Line. They're highly fortified. I would estimate approximately 14,000 enemy soldiers on the other side of those fortifications. General Rocker is seeing if they can cross over the Moselle to the south and surround the Metz to cut off any type of German supplies or any type of German advancement. Our logistics, as you know, sir, are in terrible shape. Our gasoline is running low, and we're receiving orders from Supreme Headquarters to dig in. Well, sir, I would not recommend digging in, considering the fact that we'd probably give the Germans the initiative. Intelligence reports highly suggest that we conduct or establish outposts, active outposts, and have an active running reserve in between those outposts to maintain our initiative. Keep our flow going.
All right, here's what I want you to do.
Yes, sir.
Now, this is a secret. I don't want to hear about it. This didn't happen. We're going to reconnoitre in force. So what I want you to do is you send the combat team out there. Now we have to support the combat team. So you send another combat team out there. Now, since we got so far out there, you better send some more troops to support them. And you keep doing that until we're way out there and or until we run out of gas.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
You get the 19th Air Tactical Command, as you said, I want you to fly over the Siegfried Line and get as many pictures as you possibly can and drop them down to G2 and to G1. Then I want our map topographical unit to take those maps, figure out what the hell's on the ground. I want them to print those maps, and I want them out to the troops within 24 hours. You tell them the patent said that, and you tell them they need to make it happen, or somebody's going to get skinned.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I also have a report from Lieutenant Hart, our interpreter, sir.
Prisoners in investigation has, interrogation have not revealed any new information, sir.
Who are you interviewing, the SS or the regular soldiers?
Both, sir.
Oh? Work on the regular soldiers. They don't want to be in this war. They'll probably tell you what they need to know. As far as the SS troops, I want you to put them in separate cages. Last night, they had the planes fly over the damn German Luftwaffe, actually got in here a couple of times, and they started bombing their own concentration camp. Their own soldiers in our cages. So what you do tonight, if they do it again, you let those Army soldiers out. You can't find the keys, do you understand? You can't find the keys to let the SS out.
Yes, sir.
All right.
That concludes our report, sir.
I'll be conducting the G3 brief. Major Weekly, Operations Officer. Sir, the estimated German forces in our 3rd Army Zone up here, I have the effective combat strength of 8 divisions consisting of 63,750 troops and about 175 tanks that are operational we have. And that's counting assault guns also, sir. Immediate reserves was 5 divisions with 42,000 troops and 154 tanks coming up. I'm trying to get the rush forward with Montgomery's program. We're having trouble, and I've got our guys out stealing fuel from some of the other. We're raiding as much as we can get for your instructions. We're getting every bit of drop of gas I can get my hands on to get them up here. 12th Army Group Eagle, they want us to advance to secure the Rhine River. So we're working on it, trying to get those tanks and vehicles up here so we can get our guys up. If sufficient forces are also available, they want us to take a bridgehead at Karlsruhe, if we can do that. Comet is continuing its attack up on the Metz, and are receiving heavy fighting, as you got from the earlier briefings. We're taking some heavy fire up there and suffering some casualties. Spitfire is 165 sorties, 12 missions, including 13 rail lines cut, 30 railroad cars and motor transports, and 11 locomotives damaged and destroyed. Additional 5 marshaling yards were attacked with good results. And I'm also tracking Market Garden, sir. At this time, the airborne forces, the 101st, has taken Eindhoven and secured their bridges. They lost one, but they've got Bailey and they're crossing. 30 Corps is moving very slowly, just like you suggested that they would. 82nd, sir, we've caught all our areas. We've got Nijmegen, and we're in some heavy fighting in Hunter Park and the cemetery around Hunter Park. They're fighting gravestone to gravestone, extremely heavy fighting. They have not got the Nijmegen Bridge yet. It is real nasty up in there from the reports I'm getting. From General Gavin. The British 1st Airborne, sir, has been cut off. Part of Colonel Frost, his group they got it to the bridge. They had secured one end of the bridge, and they've been cut off. Dutch Resistance is reporting a Panzer unit moved into the area, and they obviously didn't listen to their intelligence reports just like you said they would. And they landed right on top of a Panzer unit, and they've been cut off. Colonel Frost is totally cut off, and it does not look very good for them at all, sir.
All right, here's what I want you to do. Take what gas you've got, get as many men as you can across the Moselle. That's the key. We get on the other side, we're otherwise engaged. I want to get as close to Nancy as I possibly can. You tell Walker to get with Middleton, and if you have to, contact Ike. Get a hold of Doolittle first. If we can get some heavies in there on those Metz fortifications, we can bomb hell out of them, that'll be good. Now, I understand they captured some German gasoline in the Metz area. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Some of that stuff won't run our tanks.
No,
but I'll tell you what it will do. You go to some of them fortifications, you drop that gasoline down on some of them clowns that say they won't surrender, and you light it, and you give them a hot foot. If they surrender, great. If not, we'll have us a goddamn Nazi barbecue.
Yes, sir. I'll have our guys crossing the bridge tonight.
All right.
Seclusion on my briefing, sir.
All right.
Sir, that concludes the briefing from the staff at this time, and I'm sure the press has some questions for you.
Now, for y'all, and y'all are the press, what you heard was a briefing. Now, let me tell you how Patton got away with saying everything that he said. And he said what I just said. In fact, he said it a little stronger than I just said it. But Eisenhower was a little bit worried about Patton's mouth. Can you imagine? So, the press corps, although they could ask anything, they couldn't print just anything. They had to take it to the public relations officer, who was one of Ike's men. And he had to approve every single word that got out of Patton's mouth before it could be printed. Patton knew this, so he said a lot of things that just couldn't be printed. And so he had a lot of fun. And he was serious. He meant what he said when he told those people to do it. But he had a lot of fun with the press corps. And one of the questions that happened about this time is one of the press corps came up to him and said, "Sir, one of your men just said that you knocked out 66 tanks at that last battle, and our report showed it was only 33. He says, "Well, hell, don't tell Ike this, but they got some reproduction tanks and they're hard to knock out." And you know what they did? They went back and told Ike. All right, now you're the press corps, Patton's headquarters. This took place, what you just heard, was between September 16th, 18th, 19th, 20th, and 21st, right in that area. And this happened, he was in France, and he was beginning to prepare to change and maneuver his army. He had three corps that were fighting at the same time. The hardest part of what they were going to get into was Metz. Now, Metz was not just a place. It had fortifications all around, and they were left over from World War I. They were refortified. The Nazis were deep down in them. They were garrisoned by some of the toughest SS troops you could possibly imagine, and Patton's in a hurry. So what he ended up doing is leaving the 90th Division and 20th Corps and giving it to Middleton and Walton Walker, and that was their nut to crack. Once they were surrounded, then he moved his troops again, and he began to cover, and he made a pincer. Up to his north was Montgomery, and down to the south he was, and they had a pincer which worked into the Fosse Gap. Anybody know what the Fosse Gap was?
Yeah.
That was a huge gap where the Germans were trapped. He kept trying to get Monty to close the gap, and Monty wouldn't do it, and about 100,000 Germans got through there. We killed about 100,000 of them, but 100,000, and they ended up having to fight them later. The mistake that was made was you closed them off. You keep moving, and you constantly keep moving. And the reason you did that is because when you stop, they regroup. If you didn't stop, and we had the power to not stop, then they wouldn't have been regrouped, and we'd have leapfrogged them all the way into Germany. But what happened at this moment in time in history is that General Montgomery had gone to Eisenhower, and you may have heard them talking about a bridge, and the Remagen Bridge, and talking about what was Operation Market Garden. And that was an idea up north, is to punch all the way through with airborne troops, land them behind enemy lines, link up with them with infantry, and then cut the Germans short. It was a Montgomery action. It didn't work. There's a movie about it, if you haven't heard, called A Bridge Too Far.
Yeah.
A little bit Hollywood, but the idea's there. Now, how many of you have seen the Patton movie? How many believe it to be true? Well, I like the Patton movie because if it hadn't happened, you wouldn't know who the hell I am. But I gotta tell you, there are some discrepancies in there. Just think about it. Was Eisenhower anywhere in that movie?
No.
Bradley.
Bradley.
Well, you know why? You know why Bradley was in it? Because they bought two books. They bought Ladislaw Farrago's book, Ordeal and Triumph, and they bought Bradley's book, A Soldier's Life. Now you know why. All right, now, I'm going to ask you some questions and answer them as you think of some questions, because it takes a minute to warm up. How many of you like dogs? What kind of dog did Patton have?
Willie.
Had Willie. And what kind of dog was he?
Gunshot.
He was an English Bull Terrier. Now, you saw the movie, right?
Yep.
And the little dog in there at the nuts for it, and he's got his dog, and he said, this is Willie the Conqueror. And look at that little dog over there. And Colonel Codman, here's Colonel Codman. And Colonel Codman said in the movie, what did he say?
He said in the movie that he would like to have the dog at the meeting, but he also had said that the dog was ferocious, okay? So that then took the clue and went to sick the dog, and the other dog attacked him, and he retreated. Okay, so that was not what true
and
life
so,
was.
In the movie, I said, William the Conqueror, hell, I'm going to call you Willie, okay? Yeah, that's what you saw, right? That's good. You remembered it well. He didn't know I was going to do that, so he went, oh, shit. The dog was not named William the Conqueror. The dog was not at the Knutsford incident. Uh-oh. Now, what was the dog? Let me tell you how you got the dog, and let me tell you a little bit about it. This is a neat story. Those of you that would like to read a book about Patton and his family that you've never read before, or not widely read, it's called The Button Box, and it's by Ruth Ellen Totten, who was Patton's daughter, one of them, and she was the youngest daughter, and she wrote all about the Patton family, and it was about her mother, Patton's wife, Beatrice. Here's the story of the dog. When Patton's daughter was coming out at 16, she had a coming out party, and he invited all the generals. Patton was highly political. The movie is I'm No Politician is baloney. He knew. During World War II, his wife, Beatrice, was at Fort Myer, Virginia, which is not far from the White House. Do you know who she went riding her horse with every other morning?
Eleanor.
He wasn't stupid, and neither was she. Now, she was the power behind Patton. Don't ever think that she wasn't. So, back in the 1920s, he's having this barbecue for his daughter, and back then the army was segregated. There were blacks and they were whites, but they didn't commingle. No. The best cooks in the world were those black cooks, and Patton knew it. He wanted them to cook for this coming out party, and it was during the Depression. So he told them, tell you what I want you to do. We're gonna take whole steers and pigs, we're gonna roast them, and your families can come and they can eat their fill. So he's going through, and he's going through this area, and you're wondering what this has to do with the dog, a lot, okay? He's going through this area, and he goes by, and you know, if you haven't eaten much in a long time, and you eat a lot, you're gonna get a stomachache. Well, this little black guy hadn't eaten very much, and he got the stomachache, and he was wheeled over, and he says, man, I'm Little Willie Wimple. I've never been this full before. I'm as full as a tick. Now, here's something you didn't know about Patton. He could meet somebody once and remember who he met and their name 20 or 30 years later. So, he's in England and he wants a dog. And he asked Kay Summersby, who was General Eisenhower's driver and lover, and he asked Lady Lees, who was a British general's wife, can you find me an English Bull Terrier? Now, that would be a great place to find an English Bull Terrier in England, wouldn't it? You get a good one. But the war was on. So they found a place, and they found this little scrawny-looking English Bull Terrier that needed to be fed. And his name was Punch. Now, Punch had belonged to an English RAF officer, and he had been taking him over night flights over Germany because the British didn't fly over Germany during the day because they didn't have the air support. And this little dog would go up with him. One day he didn't take the little dog up. He didn't come back. So Patton saw this little orphan dog, and he saw that he was skinny, and he said, you know, I'm gonna fatten you up just like a tick, and I'm gonna name you Willie Wimple. Because he remembered. Now, if you're making a movie about Patton, that what I just told you would be really hard. How are you going to put that in the movie? You're not. So, as a way to introduce the dog into the movie, they use what they did. If you doubt what I say, go read The Button Box, and you'll get a different idea of what it was all about. She puts in there why the dog was named and how it got its name. So the movie, all of a sudden, is not quite what it was. The famous Patton speech. Remember where he stands up with all of his medals and he says, no bastard ever won a war but died for his country, made it dying for the other poor dumb bastard died for their country?
Yeah.
He never said that in the speech. That ain't how the speech begins. It begins, all this stuff you've heard about not wanting to fight, wanting to stay out of the war, a lot of horseshit. Traditionally, Americans all love to fight. All real Americans love this thing of battle. That's how it started. Now, why did he say the speech? Because he had young people who were less than 50 miles, had never in their life been more than 50 miles away from their home. They were either drafted or most of them enlisted. Now they're in the Army. They'd heard about Patton and didn't know what about it. He wanted them to see that he was a tough man, that he was going to go kill the Germans, and it wasn't, they weren't Nazi supermen. So the speech is much longer than what you see and much more profane. Patton took curse words, and he'd take a two-syllable curse word, and he'd stick another syllable curse word in it, and then finish the rest of the sentence with another curse word. And he didn't talk like I'm talking. He talked like this. Man, this stuff you've heard about America not wanting to fight is a lot of horseshit. Well, that wasn't going to work in a Patton movie with George C. Scott.
Nope.
Now, another thing, all the medals that you see him wearing, he's strutting around and he said, well, you know, and didn't happen either, okay? He wore those medals once. He was asked to come back after the war, before the Japanese had surrendered, and sell war bonds for the Pacific Theater. And he brought all the medals and awards that he'd gotten up to that time. Yeah. And he had thought about wearing them in the parade. And his wife looked at him, you know, he had a bob, and said, Georgie, that probably would be a little bit of an overstatement. And he said, okay. So, but they had Pier Johnson, who was a doctor friend of his, had one of these really fancy cameras that took a lot of color film. In 1945, that was pretty cool. So his wife had some photographs taken with him wearing all of his medals while he was there in Massachusetts at their ranch, and that's where those original color pictures took place. He wore them once, one day. So I wish the movie hadn't done that, because every once in a while they want me to wear all the medals and do this Patton, famous Patton speech that never took place in the uniform that he never wore, saying things that he never said. But other than that, it's correct. Now, a lot of times you get the impression that his men didn't like him. Well, they were kind of afraid of him, and he knew it. He used that as a way to get them to do stuff. He could sit down if a soldier wasn't in proper uniform and just rip him a new backside. And when he got through, that soldier thought that life had just ended. But that was about all that happened. And there, occasionally, now he was, if you did something really wrong, you went to the brig.
Uh-oh.
But if it was a minor infraction, sometimes it was a fine. He wanted his soldiers to follow all the rules. You could go from one area army into Patton's army, and you could notice the difference. And when you went to his headquarters, you knew the difference. And his MPs, the 503rd MP Battalion, were the honor guard of the 3rd Army headquarters. And they were perfect right through the war. And even in the middle of the mud and the goo, when it was time for an honor guard, they went out and washed the trucks and the cars and made sure that it was spit perfect. So when they did an honor guard for a visiting dignitary, it was perfect. That was a pride that he had. Now, let me tell you a little bit about the real Patton. During the Battle of the Bulge, they were in Luxembourg and they were in one of the school buildings there. And the offices, there was over 5,500 people in Patton's headquarters at that time. Now you don't think about it, that's just the headquarters, that's not all the armies. So he's there, and the weather had cleared, and they were dropping supplies in the Bastogne area. And Patton had sent C-47s over there and parachuted much needed supplies. He found out that some of them supplies had floated over and they didn't go where they were supposed to go, and the Germans got them.
Uh-oh.
He was livid. So he had this fellow in his headquarters. Now Willie was with him, and the wooden floors, and the guy's sitting there trying to figure out all this and fix it. So he knew Patton knew it, but he gonna get it fixed before Patton came to see him. And he heard a little dog. And he goes, oh no. And the dog stopped at the door. And he kind of, oh no. And the dog came in, he knew Pat would be right behind him. Boys, he said, "Yes, sir, General, sir." And he looked at him and says, "What did I hear about you having all them drops and landing in the German zone?" "Yes, sir. What have you done about it?" "Well, sir, we corrected the grid coordinates. We had the comp, and they've already landed some good supplies in there." And the guy's doing this. He says, "Are you afraid of me?" "Yes, sir." "Are you married?" "No, sir." "Well, son, when you get back to the States and you get married, you're gonna lose any fear you ever had of me." And he walked off. Now, I guarantee you for the rest of the day and afterwards, those parachute drops fell exactly where they hit in the bomb.
Yeah.
You see? And that was the kind of man he was. I'll tell you another story at the same period of time. The MPs brought a cook to him. And it says, "Sir, we found him. He is giving supplies to the locals, food." And that was against the rules. Now, the reason it was is because if you gave the food to everybody around, because they were all destitute, you have camp followers following the army all over the place.
Yeah.
So as much as they hated to do it, if they had food left over and everybody ate all they could, they destroyed it. They just couldn't do it any other way. That's war. So this cook was caught giving the stuff away. So he had the cook directly into his office. He said, "Sergeant, why are you here?" "Well, they brought me in here, sir, because they caught me giving food away." "Really? Well, who'd you give it to?" "Well, I gave it to the nuns. They didn't have any food, and they had a bunch of orphans, and they didn't have any milk. We gave them powdered milk, sir. They were orphans and the nuns, and they hadn't eaten either." "Well, that's a sorry thing." "Well, yes, sir." "Says, you know what bothers me the most? That I gave the food away?" He said, "Hell no, that you got caught, in case you do a better mission than that." You know, so he told the MPs under no circumstances was he to get caught again. So that's the kind of man he really was. It wasn't like the movies. It just not. The average soldier saw him from a distance, and the sirens and the stuff, and it was a swashbuckle, and he wore the ivory-handled pistols and the shiny helmet and the riding breeches. It was a show. He had his speech already written. He would practice the thing. You know, and then he would, now, let me tell you the other side of him that's not even in the movie. He would come, at the end of the day, he had a secretary by the name of Rockefeller, who he trusted. Patton couldn't write worth a flip. He couldn't spell. You couldn't read his writing. So he dictated at night. He would write letters to his wife home. And then he would write letters to soldiers who had families who had been lost. And he said, "Captain such and such as whatever division it was killed in the line of duty today. I knew him personally. He was a fine man. I have been closing," and whatever it was he knew about him, and sending the personal effects home. "General George S. Patton." He signed it. He didn't have somebody else sign those. And when he was through doing that, there was tears coming out of his eyes. And he told his secretary, he says, "Damn, if I'd have been a better general, maybe we wouldn't have lost a damn many of them. I gave the orders to get those boys killed." And it bothered him. Now, he would have such bad language, you would never think a man like that would have a religious belief whatsoever because of the language that he had. Yet he got down on his knees every church he went to on a Sunday morning and he prayed. And he asked the Lord for deliverance so that they could go and they could get through this with as least amount of casualties as possible. He believed that the least amount of casualties would come from killing the most amount of the enemy. The more you killed of them, the less they were to kill you. And you would just keep killing them until they surrendered or you ran out of them and you didn't give a damn which. And he would add, he called it in the movie. You see the chaplain O'Neill comes in, and he says, "I want you to make me a weather prayer." And he says, "Sir, I don't know if I can make a weather prayer. You know, I don't know how that'll be perceived." "Well, if you make me a good weather prayer and we have good weather, I stand in good with the Almighty and we'll have good weather." And they had good weather, and he said, "Bring that son of a bitch in, I'm gonna give him a medal," right? Wrong. Did not happen that way. Chaplain O'Neill, Monsignor O'Neill, was a senior chaplain and he wrote of the real encounter years later. Patton called him in, and the reason he called him in was he said, I know in the Episcopal Church, because Patton was Episcopal, you have a lot of liturgy. You stand up and you read, and you sit down, you stand up and you read, and somebody prays, and they pray, and then they're gone. He says, that's good, but how many of them actually pray? Do you actually have real prayers there? Do you ask for real forgiveness? Do you ask for real victory? Do you ask for the Lord to look over the army? He goes, no, sir. If I write you an order ordering that, would you make sure it happens? And he wrote order letter number 5, and I have a copy of it. It's real. And it asked that the men be allowed to take a moment to pray, or not pray, and ask for deliverance. Because he said to that chaplain, he says, the reason we haven't had pestilence, and the reason we hadn't had scourge, and all the sicknesses that all the armies have come through before us, is because the men and women are praying for their sons back home. And the Lord's helping us. We have to be on the Lord's side. He didn't say God's going to be on our side. He said we have to be on the Lord's side. So O'Neill said, okay. He said, now, I want you to make me a weather prayer that we can all read, like you do in the liturgy, to ask for good weather. And if you'll and make me that prayer. So he did, and it wasn't for the Battle of the Bulge, it was for the Battle of Lorraine, because all the rain was falling and everything was filling up and the men were sleeping in foxholes up to here. So he made that prayer, and in the same time he said, okay, we're getting close to Christmas, so I'll put a Christmas greeting on it. And he printed 500,000 copies of it and distributed it to all the men, and they got there for Christmas. And on Christmas Day, what happened? The sun came out. Coincidence? Providence? That's what they thought. They didn't know either. But they knew that they had a general who would pray. With all the faults the man had, he had an understanding with his Lord. And he prayed about it. And he didn't care who saw it. Now that's another side of General Patton you haven't heard. Now, I bet you have some questions.
You came ashore at Omaha and fought all the way to Austria?
Sorry, one more time?
You came ashore at Omaha Beach on D-Day, is that correct?
No. A Third Army came out after the invasion. They came, they began assembling on the beaches, Omaha and there's another one.
Utah,
and they brought them in. The MPs brought them in, they went up to the top part of France, and that started in the middle of July, and Patton's Third Army did not come operational until August 1st. And when you have to disassemble that many men in a small spot, and that's what it was, because they had to break out of the brocade area, and the idea, Operation Cobra, as they planned in the movie, that thing was planned back in England. That wasn't a spur of the thing that you saw in the movie. And the idea was to secure the area as they went in, however long it took. And then once the area was secured that they could get Patton's in army, then they assembled his army. Once the army was assembled, then they wanted to carpet bomb and open up a hole and push him through. And from the time he got pushed through, in 8 days, he had taken one corps in one direction, one corps in another direction, another corps in another direction, and had surrounded Paris and just about decimated France. Of all of the Germans that were there that could fight, many of them surrendered. And he was poised to go into Germany in 1944 on this date, and they stopped him with Operation Market Garden, and it was amazing what he was able to do. Yes.
Then later he went up into Austria. Is that right? Liberated some concentration camp.
Okay, liberation. Well, this gets out of September and August, but let me tell you, I'm going to tell you some stuff. Another thing you don't read in books. Gotta keep it short. Is that short enough?
You're the general. So you're over time, and I'm sure these folks would like to see some of the other exhibits here.
They liberated Orbendorf because it wasn't, they knew the concentration camp was there. They knew that there was Nazi secrets on and around the place, and it surprised them to find the concentration camps just like it did anybody else. That's the short answer. Come back in the next show, start with that question, I give you the long answer.
Right, 4:00.
Now, we got brochures here. If you donate a dollar, because we're nonprofit. Believe me, we don't make any money. We're nonprofit, and you can put a dollar in it if you want to. We'll give you a brochure. And Carlos Manning has a surplus place over there. And if you got any young people that would like to have something military, he'll sell it to you. But show him the brochure, and he'll give you a little bit of a discount. And we got some great grenades that are over there. They're inert. They make great show and tell in school, and take them on the airplane, and everybody will love them. All right, if you're a World War II veteran, we wanted to acknowledge you. If you can't stand, raise your hand. If you can't stand, stand. All right. This is their weekend. How'd I do?
Well, you did good.
That's all I need to hear.
Did he really get up and shoot at that airplane?
No.
That didn't happen?
No, he didn't get up and shoot at the airplane. No.
They were sure.
They did attack, and they did blow up stuff around him, but he didn't get out with a little pocket 45. He was a soldier. He knew a little bitty bullet wasn't going to take down an airplane. Now, if he could have gotten to a 50 caliber machine gun, he would have.
Thank you.
General.
Yes.
Your handguns, are those 45s? Or?
There's a 45 on this side, model 1873 single action army, and on this side was a 357 model 28.
Did they have 357s back then?
Yeah, he bought it because it was a more powerful gun than they could find. They came out in the 1930s.
Oh, okay. Is that 45? Is that the APC or the long one?
It's a long Colt. Yeah, that's the one he shot two Mexicans with in Pancho Villa. Yeah, that's the same pistol. Had two notches on it.
That was a true part of it.
You got to tell if you're a real article. Are those pros or are they ivory?
No, goddamn it, they're ivory. Only a pimp in New Orleans will have it. Or a pimp. Goddamn pearl handle. These son of a bitches are ivory. And the reason they're ivory is because they give me luck.
You're a real deal.
Very good.
General. Thank you.
You're most welcome. Coming from you, that's an honor. General? General,
this young man would like a picture with you.
Oh, I'd love a picture with him. See, you're close to 90, and I'm 125-year-old goat. What a team.